Bit of a change of plan today. I was planning on updating you on the Arenda 14. As you can see, the midframe has been painted. It's ready for assembly. The compressor rotor is fully reconditioned. The compressor cases have been painted and fully rehabilitated. And they're all ready to start going back together. We're almost at the halfway point of the project. If you want to see how we got there and follow us as we progress to a running turbojet engine, check out Patreon.com/AgentJ's. Agent JZ, Agent JZ, any one of those three. It's all the same. Spelt the same as on my channel. Okay, but this morning, even though it's been 2 weeks since the update, and that was a couple days after the original post about the Boeing 737 fifth stage bleed check valve, this showed up in my email box this morning. And this is a Saturday. Took me a while to dig this up, but it was fun chasing it down. It is ATA 36 for the B737 300 and 500 group of aircraft. If you're interested in this format, have a look. Cheers, Dave. I'll only use his first name to preserve his confidentiality. Thanks. We're going to take a look now at the actual info. Now, this is a book written for technicians working on the aircraft, and this is kind of an interface between the aircraft and the engine. Is it part of the engine? The last thing we read was about the parts of the engine that were relevant to the situation we're looking at. This one comes at it from the point of view of the aircraft. So it'll show us two things. One of them, it'll explain to us exactly what's going on with pictures. And two, well, hang on. Okay, just as a bit of a teaser to further support the point I'm about to make, which is number two about this documentation. That's the center bearing assembly of the Arenda we are going to be putting together over the next few days. So that should tell you something. That's the exploded diagram from the Illustrated Parts Catalog. Okay, the thing that should tell you, indicate to you anyway, is that it's always more complicated than you think it's going to be. So this is 30 pages. Let's see if we can quickly zap through them. We've got a block diagram, electrical contributions to the whole thing. We have the pneumatic system, a nice big rectangular block, electrical control signals. Ground start input, that's an optional input. APU input, engine input, air conditioning and pressurization. These are sources, and these are, yeah, obtained from, used by. So these are uses. Wing and cowl thermal anti-ice, and engine starting. Water pressurization, hydraulic system. What they don't show here, interestingly enough, is they don't talk about the active clearance control, which was part of the previous documentation. It's not really important about what the uses are. What we're concerned with is between the pneumatic system and the sources, I suppose. So we're going to get there. Description and operation. This, you can probably freeze this and read it if you want. It's all about the characteristics. The engine bleed valve acts as a pressure regulator, shutoff valve, and reverse flow check valve. The PRSOV, pressure regulations and shutoff valve. Bleed trip sensors, these are in the downstream ducting. The pre-cooler or heat exchanger, this is a very interesting thing. Heat exchanger, pre-cools engine bleed air. Engine fan air is ducted through the pre-cooler and back into the engine and then dumped outboard. The pre-cooler is sized to maintain 450 degrees off fifth stage air at takeoff power. All right. So, oh, here's a nice block diagram that the printer I used didn't seem to realize could have been bigger. So we've got the pre-cooler valve. This allows air to go through a really cool intercooler that would be really great for a large piston engine. We'll see that in a minute. So the fan has low pressure air at basically ambient temperature and 2 or 3 PSI, but there's a lot of it. It'll go roaring through there, controlled through this valve. So Okay, so fifth stage bleed air. At idle, 7 to 8 PSI, 183 degrees Fahrenheit, so insufficient. Takeoff, 116 PSI, 666 Fahrenheit, adequate pressure and way too hot. Cruise, 101 PSI, 600 Fahrenheit, adequate pressure and way too hot. There's the fifth stage check valve, the thing that's giving us the problems, right there. And ninth stage, idle, 22.7 PSI at 313. Temperature's okay, pressure's okay, so let's use that at idle. Takeoff, 308 PSI, 981 Fahrenheit. Whoa, that's more pressure than we need and way too hot. Cruise, 273 and 921. Again, more and more. We don't need this stuff except at idle. That's why we have this combined, the PRSOV, pressure regulation and shutoff valve. It takes it from both. You see there's a valve that shuts this off, goes up there to cowl anti-ice, and it also joins the fifth stage right there. So this little circuit was what we were concerned with, and that thing. It's nice to see the whole overall picture, because now it's very clear, isn't it? Now that we have the right information. All right, let's take a look at this. This is another thing you can freeze and read if you want. This is all kinds of information about the particular measurements and quantities of the different air at different engine power settings. N1, remember, is the, let's take a look at the diagram of the engine. N1 is the low pressure because it's the order in which things encounter the air. So the first thing the air encounters is the fan. And on the CFM56, the fan is part of the N1 system. So first, and then the second thing that the air encounters is the N2 system, which is the high pressure compressor. The fifth stage is of the high pressure compressor and the ninth stage of the high pressure compressor. They don't really show the physical parts of the engine, but you guys are smart enough to know that. The fan is the low pressure compressor with some booster stages, low pressure turbine, and then the HP compressor is driven by the HP turbine. Very cool. So that's what all these are. So in the part that we're trying to look at, oh, look at that. Fifth stage check valve. It's on the upper left-hand side of the engine. Nose cowl anti-ice duct. Okay, so that sends air straight into the cowling around the engine, which can get really cold up there, so this keeps ice from forming on it. Note that anti-ice is not de-ice. De-ice is letting ice form and then breaking it off. That's no good. So on the engine, you want to have anti-ice, which keeps everything warm so ice doesn't form. The bleed air check valve is installed in the low pressure bleed air duct to prevent bleed air from entering, returning to the engine compressor during high pressure bleed operation. The valve is mounted on the left side of each engine. The primary supply of the pneumatic air is from the fifth compressor stage of each engine through the check valve when engine speed is greater than 80% N2 speed. Okay, so 80% N2, that's the high pressure compressor, that's not 80% power. 80% N2 is going to be something like just below flight idle. So probably 20% power. A turbine is an interesting device. It makes its best power at 100% RPM and it drops off very quickly when you're running less than 100% RPM. At low thrust settings, less than 80% N2, the high stage section, ninth stage, provides bleed air for the system. Normal high stage pressure at idle, 60% N2 speed, is approximately 18 to 20 PSI within the packs, with the packs off. Okay, so can you see that? I'm sure you can. 60% N2 speed, they call it idle. That is idle. That's ground idle. Flight idle is 84% RPM. And the difference is, what is the difference? What is the difference? You see that guy? That's a CF-18 or the FA-18 coming in for a landing. So that guy's at flight idle, maybe just a touch more. What is flight idle and what is ground idle? Ground idle is the engine's running, it's got enough RPM to supply cooling air to sustainably run the engine and let it run without overheating. Starting RPM is it's running, but it's going to overheat really quickly. So it needs to go faster to supply cooling air to keep everything cool-ish. And ground idle with an aircraft has got another consideration. You've got to minimize thrust, because you don't want to be pushing forward on the brakes with 1,000 or 2,000 pounds of force. You want it to be easy to handle on the ground. So ground idle is not necessarily the best thing for the engine. The best RPM to idle at, if you have unlimited fuel, like in our test cell, is almost flight idle, because then it's even cooler. You've got more cooling air. But the compromise between producing thrust and producing cooling air is at ground idle. You want to minimize thrust, so you bring the RPM down as low as you can to minimize thrust, but as you bring the RPM down, you lose cooling air, so the temperature comes up. Thrust goes down, temperature comes up. You find a compromise as a manufacturer and you decide, yeah, that's it. It's around 60%, 65%, whatever, of RPM. Now, flight idle. The problem with ground idle is, from ground idle to significant amounts of power, if you are ground idle and you go for takeoff power, it takes 4 or 5 seconds to spool up, as they say, to get going, and then you're really rocking. Well, 4 or 5 seconds, and one of these guys in the air coming in for landing, that's forever. You measure seconds on a calendar in a jet plane. So you can't have that. You can't have lag. Imagine turbo lag of 5 seconds, or even 4 seconds. Unacceptable. If this guy's coming in a little bit too low, and he's like, whoa, give it some power, count to 5 before anything happens, that's not good. So flight idle is, you're burning even more fuel, you've got more RPM, you've got even more thrust, you might have 500 to 1,000 pounds of thrust, maybe, on a big turbofan more, but it's not really significant power for the plane. It's flight idle. You're flying and it's at idle. But it's the lowest power setting you're ever going to use in the air, because from flight idle to significant power is 1 or 2 seconds. So 1 second or 2 seconds is, it's not fun, but it's acceptable. If you really gas it, count to 1 and 2 and you're off you go with massive amounts of power. So flight idle is the minimum RPM that you want to be running, so that you're within easy reach of power to make something happen. And flight idle and ground idle on a piston engine is pretty much the same thing, because piston engines don't have that huge lag in power. There was a time that it was very difficult for airline pilots transitioning from the propeller-powered aircraft, not the turboshaft or the turboprops, but the piston-powered aircraft, and the jet aircraft. Say something like, what is that thing called? The Boeing Stratocruiser? No, that's not it. I forget the name. It's the Boeing, it's a big piston engine airliner, and then those guys would move on to the 707. It was a huge, huge change. Because coming in for a landing, you can't let the engines get going too slowly or you're helpless. I don't know, but I imagine there were a few crashes here and there from pilots used to the instant response of a piston engine with big props and a jet engine. Anyway, that's the difference between flight idle and ground idle. And if you're ever at ground idle in an aircraft powered by even turbofan engines, hopefully you're way up in the air, because you've got some time to get things back to normal. Flight idle is minimum. And typically on the aircraft we deal with, ground idle is 59 to 65%, and flight idle is 80 to 84% of RPM. Okay. All right. Switching from mid to high stage bleed on each engine is controlled automatically by the high stage valve and regulator. So when they say mid to high, they're talking 5 to 9. Fifth stage valve. The purpose of the high stage valve is to ensure adequate airflow regardless of engine RPM. The valve is installed in the 9th stage bleed duct on the right side of the engine at 3 o'clock. The regulator is remotely mounted under the fan cowl. The high stage valve is pneumatically operated, spring-loaded, closed-type pressure regulator and shutoff valve. It incorporates a plate, pneumatic actuator, pressure relief valve, and manual override. The valve may be manually locked. It's going a lot of details we weren't really... Okay. The valve is unlocked by loosening. Yeah, this is for manually setting it, which the pilot can't do. This would be something mechanics do, probably for testing procedures. Okay. The relief valve assembly is provided to relieve excess downstream pressure caused by normal port leakage past the closed butterfly plate when no consumption of air exists downstream. The relief valve assembly may be removed to expose a test port. Okay. The high stage valve will open whenever the lower pressure fifth stage bleed valve is insufficient or at engine shutdown. The regulator receives a reference pressure from the airframe side of the high stage valve. When the valve is open, the regulator will modulate the valve's output to maintain 25 to 35 PSI, with the optimum being 29. Yes. So, some pictures. We like pictures. This has the high stage valve. This may be the low stage valve without a title, because this thing looks different than that thing, doesn't it? It does to me. It looks different. So it's often you'll find in documentation missing bits. And so you have to, first of all, you interpolate and you guess. And then you go and talk to an older guy who's worked on these, and he goes, yeah, they missed that in the manual. That's what it is. This is the low stage valve. Okay, interesting. I'm not sure what that is. I'm guessing this is the fifth stage valve and this is the ninth stage valve. Somebody's going to correct me, I'm sure. Here's an operation graph, I suppose, a graphic. Idle, N2, 60%. Look at that, ground idle. The high stage valve opens on engine start and regulates to 29 PSI is increased. Okay, so my guess was wrong. The high stage valve is the valve that controls both. Yes, and this other diagram, I'm not quite sure what it is. Let's see, we've got this again. High stage valve comes off the ninth stage. Okay. And the PRSOV is the main one that feeds the aircraft, supposedly, or I guess. Interesting. So there is no valve on fifth. The fifth stage is always open. And it's shut off and controlled by this thing. Fifth stage valve is always going to go cowl anti-ice until this pressure opens and overrides it and shuts that check valve. It's seeming more simple and more complicated as we go. Okay. I got that. Pressure regulation and shutoff valve. Limits downstream pressure. There's a lot to do with the temperatures, and I want to get to the intercooler. Okay, this is the electrics of the thing. You can pause that and read at your leisure. There's also a physical temperature override safety switch, which is the 450-490 thermostat, and it is independent of the switches that control things below 490. Okay, so this is like an actual physical, non-electrical thing. As the temperature increases, the hermetically sealed oil within the sensing tube expands and acts upon the bellows assembly. The resulting force against the bellows causes the output rod to move the metering valve off the seat and thereby produce flow through the control port out the metering valve to ambient. The regulated airflow develops a pressure drop across the control port. As the temperature increases, the metering valve opens up farther, allowing more airflow through the control port with an associated larger pressure drop. The result is a decrease in output signal in response to increase in temperature. Similarly, the temperature decreases, fluid contraction, it goes the other way. Okay, the metering valve is modulated to provide a variable bleed port pressure for each temperature between 450 and 490 Fahrenheit. These ports are internal in the thermostat. During normal engine operation, the pre-cooler should maintain air temperatures below a maximum of 440. There's your pre-cooler. Okay, so this is fan discharge air, relatively cold and low pressure, blasting through essentially a giant intercooler, fan air exhaust. And this is exhausted I believe it's exhausted outside to the ambient. Purposes bleed air to approximately 390 to 440. Two pre-cooler systems are provided, one for each engine. Air-to-air heat exchanger, 4-inch diameter pre-cooler control valve, intercooler control valve sensor, and a solenoid valve installed in the sense line between the valve and sensor. It's an air-to-air heat exchanger located at the top right center of each engine and is of plate fin single pass cross flow type. The heat collected from the hot air above 390 ducted from the engine is absorbed by the cool air ducted from the engine fan after passing through an intercooler, a pre-cooler control valve. The cooling air is then discharged overboard, so not into the fan duct, because it wouldn't go back into the fan duct. If the fan air is at 2 psi and it goes through this resistance, it's now lower in pressure and it's not going to go back into the fan duct. As a matter of fact, if it went back into the fan duct, then the pressure there and here would be equal and there'd be no flow. So this has to go to the outside of the fan duct. There's going to be a grating or an exit matrix for intercooler air somewhere on the engine cowl. And so somebody that works with CFM56 engines in Boeing 737s will be able to confirm that for us. Pre-cooler control valve. So as you can see, you can always freeze and read that if you want. Ah, the overall. This isn't even the overall. Let's go back to our, where's our block diagram? Okay, the pneumatic manifold is a thing. It's a lot of things, a lot of valves and things. It's this, the pneumatic system. The sources and the uses are outside of this. So what we thought was a simple pipe and a couple of valves is, interestingly, always more complicated than we thought. I don't know what a turbofan valve is, but it sounds exciting. The pack valves aren't discussed. We obviously know very little about the entire system. Pressure relief valve. The PSROV is in the next diagram. See, I'm kind of going through this the first time with you guys. I looked at it for about 5 minutes, but there's the people that work on these things have to know the systems inside and out. APU bleed valve is a different part of what the, had nothing to do with the airworthiness. Duct pressure indicator. Isolation valve. I'm only showing this to show that it is always more complicated than you think. External air. Maximum pressure for engine starting is 45 PSI. So, and you've got a duct that's pressurized. So after engine start, duct system pressure must be bled off before disconnecting ground air supply. Otherwise, you'll get a 30 PSI by 4-inch diameter pipe blowing back, blasting back in your face, which is not going to be too safe. And it's also going to be 400 degrees. Yeah, does it say 450? Maximum pressure and temperature of the ground air supply is 60 PSI and 450. It's going to be somewhere up to that. Yes. Pneumatic panel, more things, more pilot things. An overall picture of what we're looking at. The PRSOV is on each engine, and this will lead to wing anti-ice. The pack valve, I think that's got something to do with the air conditioning system. The check valves for the APU so that engine bleed air can't go back and run the APU or run it backwards or just make it spin and not do what it's supposed to do. There's the fifth stage check valve. There's the item, the animal we've been concerned with all along. It's just a simple thing. But this does prove one thing that I guessed at before, is that it will be relatively easy to access. There'll be a panel that opens up on the nacelle of the aircraft, and right there is there's possibly a fairing panel over top of that, but the bleed valve or the check valve is relatively accessible, which is good. The difficulties dealt with in the Airworthiness Directive have probably all been taken care of before I even make this video. Latest material, October 99, right up to date. Absolutely. High stage valve. Valve control pressure regulator. Downstream. Okay. Another, the PRSOV. All right. These overall views are extremely helpful, especially to interested people like you and me. Another diagram of this massive intercooler. I'd like to see one of those things. But yeah. APU. APU check valve. This is going to be very similar to the fifth stage check valve. Probably almost, it's not going to be the same part number, but it's a very, very similar device to the thing that I showed you last time. Duct pressure transmitter. This looks exactly like an air pressure switch on the Arenda 14, which you'll be seeing us install in a few weeks' time. And there we go. That's a check valve with an actuator attached to it and the ground service. All right. Okay, now that we know exactly what the mechanisms are, exactly how they all interact, and exactly what's going on, the whole ADA makes a lot more sense than the quick wording that was there. So I guess FAA ADAs are not meant for guys like you and me. They're meant for the experts who are dealing with that stuff all the time, and they know exactly what that is. That's why this was probably a quickly solvable problem. Didn't cost a whole lot of money, and that's great. But I'm just glad I got this information. So now I understand what's going on, because when I first read it, I was confused. Yes. I don't think I've ever seen a Boeing 737 started by auxiliary air connection from the outside, but they do have that capability. And that's what I got to do in Oshkosh 2019 with Jeff Caney's F5. Interestingly, there's two engines, and you stick the APU on there and they fire up that engine. Then they depressurize it, of course. Then you pull it off and you stick it onto the connection for the other engine. I would have thought there'd be one connection and just a valve that he switches in the cockpit, but hey, I'm not an aircraft designer. And that would have been probably heavier and more expensive anyway. But anyway, now that we all know exactly what's going on, we can feel safer about the Boeing 737 flying over our heads. Also, of course, thank you to the Blanco Lirio channel for bringing this issue to my attention and getting me started on the whole journey of investigating and finding out what's going on. It's been fascinating. So, thanks for watching.